would like to thank each and every one of you for having registered and made yourselves available to participate in this webinar, which is a joint initiative of the National Institute of Urban Affairs and World Vision India. The purpose of this webinar is to discuss the impact of COVID-19 and the impact particularly on the lives and livelihoods of slum dwellers in Indian cities. And the basis for our discussion this evening would be a study, which is a rapid assessment study that has been carried out in 10 cities, covering 100 households in each city, and three peri-urban areas, where 50 households per peri-urban area has been covered. Now, none of us can deny that COVID-19 has impacted us, as we probably have never been impacted before. A recent study by the Azim Premji University, which is the COVID-19 livelihood survey, indicates that almost 8 out of 10 workers in urban India have lost their jobs. 70% of rural and 80% of urban households did not have money for a week's worth of essentials. 34% of rural and 43% of the urban population took loans to cover personal expenses. As World Vision India, we've ourselves, in order to inform us ourselves on our future strategy, have also done a rapid survey of the 118 locations where we have our area programs covering about 5,668 households. And by and large, we find that there is a fair degree of impact that we can talk about in terms of how COVID has affected the lives of people. In fact, this survey actually shows that only about 4% of the respondents say that their lives have not significantly been affected, and that either moderately or severely affected is almost 96%. And clearly, there are several studies of this kind which are going on. I just saw one on gender-based violence in Afghanistan with 336 respondents, which again showed some very, very salient findings in terms of what and how COVID is impacting their lives. When we look at the pictures of migrant labor and laborers trekking across India with their families, we can sometimes see the pain, the challenges that the disease has actually imposed on us. And it is to look at this, particularly from the point of view of the urban context where many of these migrants used to work. Some of them have left and moved back to their hometowns with great difficulty, walking sometimes on very, very basic personal transport, cycling all the way sometimes. And many of them are left behind. And what does it mean for them? It means that many of them are living in COVID-19 hotspots, whether it's slums in Delhi or Mumbai or Ahmedabad. And therefore, these questions would come up as to what does it mean for them. And it is really to answer this question that this webinar would really be very, very helpful. So the questions that would be asked are, what is the impact on livelihood and household income? How has it affected the physical and psychological health, education? What kind of coping mechanisms are people adopting during the lockdown? How are social protection schemes helping them? And are there significant intercity variations? So these questions would be answered. And for that, we have three presenters. We would start with Professor Debolina Kundu from the National Institute of Urban Affairs, who would share the study with us for about 20 minutes. That would be followed by Ms. Clara Raphael, who would talk about findings of the study from some of the cities where World Vision has its specific city urban programming initiatives. And then we would have Dr. Anjana Purkayastha, Senior Director, Urban Programming, World Vision India, who would look at the impact on children. And after this is kind of covered for about 35 minutes, we would have two respondents. And for that, we have Professor Darshini Mahadevia from Ahmedabad University, as well as Professor Amita Bide, the Dean of the School of Habitat Studies from the Tata Institute of Social Sciences, Mumbai. So that's broadly the structure. And then at the end of that, we would have an open house. We would have time for discussions between the participants and the panel, and then a summary. So we hope to complete this whole process by about 7:45 p.m. So thanks once more. And as we would normally hear it said, less heard these days, is that sit back, relax, and hopefully you can listen to what is being said. So over to Professor Debolena Kundu.
Thank you for this excellent introduction. Without taking much time, let me start with my presentation. So, as Mr. Cherian just now mentioned, that this is a joint initiative by World Vision India and National Institute of Urban Affairs, New Delhi. And this project is a part of the UKRI funded project on sustainable, healthy and learning cities and neighborhoods. We have seven country partners, and it's being led by the University of Glasgow. I'm not going into the details in the interest of time. So what I'll quickly do, I'll run through the slides, and we have a big list of team members from both from National Institute of Urban Affairs as well as from World Vision India. I'll take up just a few names. Ms. Pragya Sharma, Dr. Tania Devnath, Vishwajit Kaur, they have been, Rakesh, they have been really working for the last 1 month on this. And we got immense support from Dr. Anjana and Ms. Clara, along with other staff from Vision, to whom we are grateful for this collaboration. The context, as was mentioned by the chair, that cities are the hotspots of COVID-19, and the pandemic has really aggravated the existing inequality. As we all know, that as per 2011 census, we had 17% of the country's population living in slums, and maybe the share has increased. And with the pandemic, the slum dwellers who are vulnerable, their vulnerability has increased manifold, both in terms of securing livelihoods and also practicing social distancing, which is a norm to really help oneself from not contacting the virus. And what is the urgent need? It's we all know that understanding the impact of the pandemic really it's very essential to in order to influence policy. And in this regard, we did a rapid survey of 10 cities and a few peri-urban areas. The major issues which we touched upon were livelihoods, food security, knowledge on COVID, women and domestic violence, access to basic amenities, which are all again had an impact on social distancing, and education and health. So we have divided the presentation into three parts. I'll be looking at livelihoods, food security, and access to basic amenities. And the other three areas will be dealt by my colleagues from the World Vision. I'll quickly run through the methodology, because it was a telephone survey, that was one of the major limitations. It was not a face-to-face survey. So we restricted our interventions in 10 major cities and 2 peri-urban locations. This was followed by a questionnaire preparation, pilot testing, and randomized selection of households. The telephone survey took place between 27th May, 24th April to 7th May. It was a 15 to 20 minutes of survey. And we pre-recorded the consent of each of the household whom we interviewed. And this was also followed by, and at times it did happen parallelly, that there was a focus group discussion with the World Vision volunteers who were working there to get a knowledge of the field experience. And we had a sample of 1157 households with 5815 members. And the sample included 21 houseless households as well. Now, these were basically from Kolkata. These households did have a house, but with the increase in the rent, they could not afford So they currently they are staying in the footpaths, making in makeshift arrangements. So we also clean the data and tabulation and analysis and report writing is underway, but we thought we let us bring out the quick results for the larger audience. The locations of the research is as such, we have Anantnag as a peri-urban area. We took 50 households here. We have Bangalore, Chennai, Delhi, Guwahati, Hyderabad, Indore, Jaipur. Again, Kanchipuram is a peri-urban area. Here we had two locations. We have another three cities, Kolkata, Mumbai, and Srinagar. So this shows the location. It's not from one location we have taken. It's more or less spread across the city so that we could get a sense of how slum dwellers have really been impacted. Another important point I would like to mention here is all the photographs which we are showing are from the slum locations. What we find when we look at the household characteristics is that 16% are women headed, 71% of the households, when you look at the religion, we find 61% are Hindus, 32% Islamic households, followed by 6% Christians and others are 1.4. If we look by social groups, we find just 10% STs, whereas 31% are SCs, 21% OBCs and the rest are the others. And by economic status, 43% households are BPL, moderately poor, or the new poor, which we will discuss in the later slides, is 28%, and non-poor is around 30%. So this photographs here, the collage shows different types of locations which we have covered. We have peri-urban villages, notified slums, non-notified slums, and also squatters. So our entire sample was a mix of both migrant and non-migrant households. Migrant households were around 30%, but since they have come at various points of time, some are at more than 30 years, they are staying in that location. So I think if we really look at migrants, that would be 6.4% who have come in the last 10 years. When we are looking by the principal types of employment, we find 46% casual laborers in our sample, 23% self-employed, 28% regular workers. Yeah, so we had divided the economic status of the sample into three groups, the BPL, which is 43%, the new poor, 28%, and the non-poor, 30%. Casual laborers are the maximum, followed by the regular salaried workers, and then the self-employed and others. When we look at the principal source of income, what do we find? It's the casual laborers, again, 46%, followed by the regular salary and the self-employed. And when we look by the households, by the sector of employment, we find that maximum is in the service sector, followed by construction, transport, trade and hotel, and manufacturing. That means most of the people working here are part of the service industry. The impact on the employment and income is very visible in this photograph. This is from Bangalore, one of the slum locations, vertical slums. When we look at the impact on principal source of income, we find all types of households have been impacted, whether it's the poor, the new poor, or the BPL, but the impact is maximum on the BPL. I'm not going into the figures in the interest of time, I'm restricting my presentation to the major findings. When we looked at by household type and the impact on the main source of income, what we found is that 8.9% of the self-employed were impacted, followed by both casual laborers and regular salaried workers. We asked a question about the distribution of households by nature of impact. How did the COVID and the lockdown, I won't say COVID, but the majorly the lockdown impact on the household's income. So the major finding was that 91% of the BPL households, they lost their jobs. Again, the new poor, among the new poor, 86% lost, non-poor 75% lost. So it was the lockdown impacted all types of households across economic categories. And when we look at who has lost employment by economic activity, we find it's the casual wage earners, which was the maximum, more than 94%, followed by the self-employed, and then we had the regular workers and the others. City-wise, we find again the big cities, that job loss of job was less, but the salary cut was very high, whereas in the small towns, the job loss was maximum. Impact on household income. Significant decline happened for the BPL households, followed by the new poor and then the non-poor. By gender, the single headed, where we find the women headed households, there we find the maximum loss of employment. So what type of coping strategy did these different types of households they take up? Firstly, around the same percentage, 30% of households, they tried to run their families from their own savings, and another 30% took money from friends and relatives, followed by external money lenders, another 11%, and they were borrowing from local shops, another 11%. So this is the major scenario we find. Principal coping strategies was again, as I mentioned, maximum for 34.4% of the non-poor, they had their savings to support their families. This is the city level scenario. I'm not going into the details. But money lending from friends, this is a major share, followed by borrowings from the local shops. Social distancing, as we all know, is one of the major strategies put forward to really help us from not contracting the virus. And if we look at whether the households are really in a position to do so, the people living in the congested slums, I think most of all of them do not have large spaces to distance each other within the household and also from their neighbors. And congestion is really high in the big cities, and small towns are slightly better off in terms of living space. And when we look at fetching water or taking water from shared sources of, for drinking purpose, we find Kolkata, Hyderabad, Delhi, I think Kolkata and Hyderabad, they really depend on public water taps. Same is the case of Kanchipuram. So here, social distancing is really a challenge. Access to bathroom is again a challenge across all households. But in case of Mumbai, we found that makeshift arrangements were made within the household, within the same room. They made a space for taking bath. So the figures are much higher, but otherwise, when we look at the bathroom facilities, it's not that good across all 12, 13 locations, the cities where we have studied. Same with toilet facilities, latrine facilities, we have only 59% of the households who have exclusive right to the toilet, but the others are basically using shared services. This figure, you see, it's 99% from Mumbai, because each room, each slum dweller has a makeshift arrangement within the household. So that really shows the high figures. But for the others, it's basically shared facilities. And when we compare the migrants and the non-migrants, we find the position of the migrants, it's slightly better when we look at the access to bathrooms and latrines, and also the average size of the room. When we look at the support system, we find that there are measures taken by the government across all state governments. I'm not reading out the figures, but it's generally between 1,000 to 5,000 cash transfer rupees, 500 by the central government under PMGKY, Pradhan Mantri Garib Kalyan Yojana. So each household is entitled to rupees 500, provided they have a bank account. And also there are targets for cash transfer by various state governments to auto drivers, to different types of beneficiaries. They could be widows, they could be migrants, families without ration cards. But these have come up off late. These measures were not there when we took up the survey. At that time, we basically had the PDS running, and our survey does show that 78% of the households did have a ration card, and 24% above BPL households also did have, and 65% below BPL. And there were variations across cities. But when we look at specifically at the rations, we find 63% did have access to PDS. Access to direct DBT was through PMGKY was 23%, and 40% got cash transfers through other schemes, both government and private. One important interesting finding, when we look at city level figures, we find that Anantnag stands as an outlier with 100% of the households availing PDS. And this is the major reason behind this is that Kashmir was under lockdown August 2019. And most of the households are covered under PDS. So that explains this high figure. And students who were going to school did get midday meals in most of the public schools. So that had stopped with lockdown. But there we had a question on whether the share of whether the households were getting some sort of midday meal scheme even after the lockdown happened. And the average was 52% for Kolkata, followed by Srinagar 50%. But some cities did not get at all, but many cities did, many households did get access to midday meals in terms of dry ration. And these are, this sample is only for those households who have reported children studying in elementary, at the elementary level. So we also asked a question on the opinion of lockdown. So most of the households, above 50%, said that it's much needed. Around 27% said it's somewhat needed. And 19% said not needed at all, because they said that hunger will kill us if not COVID. Across this is also explained by this graph, where we find that by this, when we look at the economic status of the households and their opinion, it's the people who live below poverty line and the new poor who were not much in favor of the lockdown. So what are the policy implications? I'll just briefly complete. This is the last slide I'm touching upon. So we found that a new class of new poor is emerging very rapidly, and the concerns of this vulnerable class needs to be addressed urgently. There is also urgent need to address food insecurity because we keep getting phone calls from the sample households whom we surveyed in many of the cities. They keep calling the World Vision staff saying that you came for the survey, now where is our food? So they are still in a dire state of food insecurity, and I think that this is one of the areas where urgent steps need to be taken. Although World Vision and other NGOs, the Gurdwaras and other philanthropy organizations are there helping the poor with food, but I think the intensity of this needs to really come at a much higher pace, and the government should step up in providing food across slums in all cities. And not only food, but also cash support is very important. And real-time tracking of health and livelihood conditions is also very important. And we found that social distancing is not possible because of the high congestions. Several people living in the same room, most of the households having one room, people going to the common toilets and drinking water facilities. So there, the government should really take some immediate actions and provide food, not only food, but also housing and basic amenities with a lot of inbuilt subsidy in the programs. Poverty and job loss needs to be tackled immediately. And there should not be two options between lives and livelihoods. I think both are very important and both demand equal and urgent attention. Thank you very much for your attention. I'll get back to questions at a later stage. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Debolina. There have been a few questions and comments which have been put in the chat box. We will take them up at the appropriate time. We have a time for that. We would now have Clara make her presentation, followed by Anjana.
Thank you, Mr. Charyan. Actually, I'm Clara from World Vision, and I would be sharing few indicators on the impact of lockdown on children. And the first slide I would like to please. The first slide is on household reported children spending maximum time inside the home. And when we look at the cities, the two cities and very urban area like Mumbai and Jaipur, we found that 100% children were at home. And I would like to share the few reasons for that, because where we are working in the community, it's a containment zone, and lockdown restricted people's movement. And police patrolling kept children inside their house. And parents and children were well informed on COVID. That's one thing. And as we know, in Mumbai, Dharavi, there are high cases of COVID. And so parents themselves kept the children inside their house. That is one thing what we found. And when we look into the Anantnag, there it's a very urban area. It's not a containment zone, actually. And parents were well informed on COVID. Children were very apprehensive about COVID. So that's the reason they also didn't want to come out. And here, actually, children had sufficient space to move around. And they had the courtyard too. So there is no question of coming out. Usually, children always said, they are always inside their house. That is what we found through the findings. And then Hyderabad city, when we looked at it, it was a bit surprise to us, actually being the city hotspot. We found that 58.3% children were playing in the community. So when we just found out the reason, it was told that the survey revealed actually the people, children were playing within the community. They were inside the community and they felt that was safe. They did not come outside the community because it was not a containment area. So that's the reason it showed 58.3% children were outside, because it is not a containment community area, the zone where they were. And when we look at the other places, a downward trend, except Mumbai, Jaipur, and Anantnag, where all with 100% children were inside their house. But when we look at the other cities and especially the very urban areas, it was children were able to move outside very freely. That is what it is. Next slide, please. Yeah, this indicator reveals that unusual behavioral changes during lockdown. When we look at the respondent, about 1,069 respondents were there, and the average percentage is about 38.6% mentioned that children reported unusual behavior. So we looked into it. The big cities like Mumbai, Delhi, Jaipur, Kolkata reported unusual behavior. It was very high. So the reason being that children had to stay in a small room, as Dr. Deboli had mentioned. It was just one room. Many family members were there, about 6 to 12 people were staying in just a small room, and 24/7. It was a real challenge, and children were not allowed to go out. That was one thing they felt, where they had an unusual behavior. And accessing toilets, community toilets, also was a challenge for them, because sometimes the toilets was also locked and kept. And the other thing was shortage of food. They were not getting a regular food. Actually, they were having only two meals a day. Some of them said even one meal a day. So it was a challenge. And so children didn't want to be at home. And the other thing is parents frequently quarreled among themselves. So that was a real challenge for the children. That's the main reason they had the unusual behavior in the cities. And when we look at the peri-urban area, it was very low. The reason is children had opportunity to play in their, because the houses were very large, the rooms were very big. And especially in Kanchipuram, where it's a village, that people, children were able to come out and play with other children. So they didn't feel that much. That's the reason the rate is very low. And one thing what we heard from Kanchipuram peri-urban area is that they lacked food insecurity. They didn't get a proper food because of lack of income. That brought little hardship to them. And the other thing, the next slide, please. The unusual behavior pattern, when we look into it, is a principal behavior change, where we found that out of 770 respondents, 44% said that children were irritated. They had irritated behavior because they cannot go out to play. This was a very great challenge for the children, because children said they were missing their friends and they were not able to meet them. The other thing what they said was parents were frequently quarreling and they were not able to be with in the house itself. So that was a great challenge that they found. And parents usually quarrel because they did not get income. That is the main reason. So that environment was not conducive for the children. And the other thing, when we look at the 24.7%, it's mentioned as children disturb their parents and fights with their siblings. This was because of children had nothing to do. Usually parents get something when they go out, when they come in the evening, they buy something for the children, and children, they make children happy. But during this period, lockdown period, they were not able to go and get things as children wanted. So that really irritated the children. And one thing I would like to mention over here is that prior to this telephonic survey, we had a call with the all the children in the seven cities. We had a Zoom call, and we want to listen to the voice of children. And children shared many things that really affected them. But one thing they shared was, hinted was, they didn't openly tell us. One thing that they hinted was about the child abuse that was happening at home. So we knew that that's the main reason there was fight among siblings, because this is an hidden agenda. So what we thought was, after the post lockdown, we will be going to them, visiting them and finding out their issues and support appropriately. We will provide that support. That is one area we really had a challenge to get information from them. And the other one is 9.5% children reported unusual eating pattern. This is where we heard that quantity of food was reduced. It was not usual way of having food. They had the food was reduced. They didn't have three times a day. And that really irritated them and irritated the children. And the quality, it was not as expected. They wanted certain way of having the food, but the quality was not that great because parents were not able to provide that sort of quality of food. And the type of food was also was not up to the expectation of children, because whatever parents had, that they had to give. This is one of the unusual behavior children had. They had irritation, they had fights, all was because of this. And the other thing what we were looking at is 10.3%. We see crying all the time. This is children below the age of five. They were not able to really understand the situation, COVID situation. They wanted the whatever they expected, like they wanted snacks. So parents were not able to provide that. So that is how they were all a little cranky, and they were crying for that. That it's about 10.3%. And when we look at the other academic activities, it's about 4.5%. Children, parents said that children had a fear of whether they will be able to continue their study, whether they will be able to cope up, how long this lockdown will extend. All this was in their mind bothering them. So these are reasons for their unusual behavior pattern. And so this is, we after lockdown, I think for post-lockdown, we'll be able to understand in a better way when we meet them face to face. That's it. I request Dr. Anjana to take it.
Thank you, Clara. Yeah, I would like to take you to the slide that is before us. It's on children's access to online platforms. And we all know that during the lockdown period, accessing the net has been a lifeline for all of us, either rich or the poor. But here we are going to look at how children were able to access the online platforms. And we all know that in our slums, during our studies, we have found out that children primarily access the online platform for two basic reasons. One is to get into the social media, interact with their friends and do gaming and all sorts of recreational activities. And second is to also access their studies. And what we see here out of all the cities and the two peri-urban areas, Delhi tops the list. Almost 50% of the children in Delhi were able to access online platforms. There are a couple of reasons for that. One reason being, in all the slums of Delhi, wherever we are working, either it is Madanpur Khader or the Anand Parbat, which is a transit camp, or Sonia Vihar or any other places, what we have found that every household would have at least one basic Android phone. It may be a second-hand Android phone, but they had one Android phone. That is one of the reasons. And second is, even in that family, they also would have a second Android phone. So due to which the children were able to easily access the online platform. And here, very interestingly, one more city that is factored in is Guwahati, where we see 46.5% of the children were also able to access online platform. There are a couple of reasons. Let me share the reason. One of the main reason being when the survey was done, that time the number of cases in Guwahati were reported to be very less. So although that was a lockdown situation, but largely the children would come out of their home and they would also sit in groups, and one child would share his or her phone with a group of children. So that's how they were able to access the online platform. And second reason is, in Guwahati, the slums where we are working, if anybody is connected from Assam, you would know the places like Uzan Bazar, Bhutnath, Bamuni Moidam, and all these places, they're centrally located in the city, and where connectivity is very, very good. So every households where we work, we have seen one common phenomena, that whatever form of basic Android phone they purchase. And that is how the children were also having access to online platform. Another thing that we have seen here, Anantnag, which is a peri-urban community, where we see that 51.4% of the children were also able to access the online platforms. The specific reason being, we know the context in Kashmir. And anything that happens in Kashmir, Anantnag is one of the places where it is firstly affected. So many of the households, we found out, they all have a basic Android phone. And that is not for any other reason but to access information. So hence the children were able to access the online platform. Next slide. Here we see the access to digital media and how it impacts the behavior of the children. What we have found out in a study that higher the percentage of children having access to digital media, the amount of unusual behavior was reported high. So what we found out here, especially the children who are in the age group of 12 to 17, during the daytime, they would be almost glued to their mobile phone. They would be either downloading many other applications, they'll be exploring many other things on the phone, or they'll be in touch with their friends or whatever. And it would be very irritating for them if anybody calls them during that time. So that's why what we find that whenever they had higher access to online platform, they exhibited unusual behavior. Domestic violence. We have heard about it. We have watched it on television. We have read in the print media that during this lockdown period, the incidents of domestic violence really spiked. And this is also a concern of the government because the number of cases have been reported to be higher. And in our community also, when we were doing the survey, we found that 40% of the household, the total number of the respondents are 463, the 40% of the households reported increased domestic violence due to the lockdown. And there are two reasons why we see 40%, which is significant, but we also believe that it could be a little higher. It could be 60 or 70% even. The reason that it is 40% and not high at this point of time, one is the female respondents, when they were responding to this very, very sensitive inquiry, their husband used to be around them, because places like Dharavi and the slums in Jaipur, slums in Delhi and all, we know that it's very congested and most of them had only one room to dwell in. So husbands would be around, or the children would be around, or some of the relatives would be around. So it was very difficult for them to discuss about this very sensitive matter. And then we also found that the type of domestic violence that faced by the women, 53.6% of the women, they expressed that there is increased quarrel, the squabbles in the family. It's because of the fact that they had no income. And we also have a other category, 31.2% of the women, they responded. This is largely due to the fact that the women are humiliated at home. They were also threatened by the men, especially the husbands at home. Can we go to the next slide? Let me share with you the impact on health. During this lockdown, it has really affected the people seeking the treatment from their neighboring places. And here we see that 39.8% of the households that were surveyed, they have reported that they had challenge in accessing treatment. And here we see that Srinagar, 75% of the people had difficulties in accessing the regular treatment. One reason, because during the COVID, they also had a pre-COVID situation. They had a lockdown period before COVID situation. And because of the prolonged shutdown, they had real difficulty in accessing health treatment. We also see that same phenomena in Bangalore. And Bangalore, it is because of the fact that the community where we are working, they're largely migrant laborers. And they did not have enough money to seek regular treatment. Next slide. Now, what are the nature of problem in availing the regular health facilities? Here we see that 48.3% of the household, they mentioned that transport was the biggest issue during the lockdown. And 47% of the people, they have mentioned that they did not have money to avail the health facilities. Next slide. Let me also share with you the knowledge about COVID-19 in the community. What we see here, 98.8% of the household, they have information about COVID. Now, what are the source of information about COVID? What we find here, 79.3% of the people, the respondents, they shared that World Vision India really played a huge role in generating the awareness. And this is a very consistent effort from World Vision India, and all the staffs are also trained, volunteers are trained, the children are trained in the clubs. So because of which we see a higher amount of awareness. And second source of information, which is 78.7%, is from the television. Next slide. Let me share with you the knowledge about the symptoms of COVID. 87.6% of the household, they mentioned fever as a symptom. 61.9% household, they mentioned sneezing as a symptom. But very interestingly, very few households, they were aware about the asymptomatic nature of the carrier of COVID-19. Next slide. Now, one of the critical thing about evading any infection during this lockdown period, we know it is hand washing. So what we see here, 98.5% of the surveyed household, they reported that they have washed the hands very frequently. And this is because of the consistent efforts of World Vision India, the awareness that they have raised. Next slide. Now, strategies adapted to maintain social distancing. This is my last slide. What we see here, 89.9% of the respondents, they have mentioned that they went out of their houses only when they had to avail some very essential or critical services. Otherwise, they were largely inside home. 17.5% of the respondents mentioned that they had difficulty in social distancing because of the habitation, which is congested, and also because they had to share the toilets, common toilets were there. So with this, I come to the end of my presentation. And post lockdown, we are going to resume this study again with NIUA. And we believe that together with NIUA, we will be able to access more information from our community, which will help us to assess the long-term implication of COVID-19 on our children and the community that we serve. Thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you so much, Anjana. Thank you for the presentation. What I would do is, before I ask our distinguished discussants to respond to the presentations, I will just take three questions. These I would direct to Professor Debolina Kundu, because these are very basic. These are very basic questions that are important for us to understand the study. The first question is about why these 10 cities? How did we make the choices of these 10 cities? The second is, how did we classify poverty? How particularly new poor? I know it was there in the presentation, but I think one of the questions, I think it'll help to clarify how the new poor is defined. And the third, I think again, fairly relevant question is, did we ever ask in our questions to the migrants who were part of the surveys, whether they ever wanted to get back home? So if you can specifically answer these three questions, and then we will go on to the discussants. Why these 10 cities? Who are the new poor? And did we ask the question to the migrants, to the newer migrants, do they want to go back home?
Thank you, Mr. Thomas. The first question, that why did we take these 10 cities? I think the first answer is because World Vision has their interventions in the seven cities, My City Initiative. So seven cities came directly from there. And the other locations where Anjana ji is just now working, so we thought data access or conducting the study would be easier if we take these locations. That was it. And as you know, the households were selected at random across various locations within the slum communities. So the second question is with regard to the new poor, if I understand.
That's right.
So the last time the Planning Commission gave us the figures was 2011-12. So we updated that figure to the current monthly per capita consumption expenditure of the month of February, because we did not take the month of March, because the lockdown had already partially started. So February was the safer month, and we could have taken the previous months, but the annual 1 year per capita consumption expenditure and that of February did not vary much. So we thought it was safe to compare with February. And with the BPL population, the APL we divided into two, and the first class was added with the BPL to form the new poor, the most vulnerable, and the non-poor was the APL category. So this is how we have gone about.
Thank you.
Pardon me, can I have your third question,
the
please?
Third question is whether you asked the question to many of the migrants, particularly the newer migrants, whether they wanted to go back to their homes, to their hometowns where they came from.
No, we did not ask this question. We did ask a question about going back home, was with regard to any member of the family who has already started going home or would like to go home. So the answer was for the household was no. And I think an insignificant percentage had started going home, but they were in safer locations with some of their relatives or somewhere in the city. So that
Thank you.
The problem which we are facing, that we did not come across the slum communities.
Thank you. Thank you so much. I'm also very mindful of time, and it's quite important that we try and finish soon. So we will take up a few more questions after we have the responses from our discussants. So I would first ask Professor Darshini Mahadevia from Ahmedabad University. Her focus would be a little more on what are these lessons for urban planning. And I know these are not detailed studies. These are very, very rapid surveys, but quickly, some lessons for urban planning. And from, she'd be followed by Professor Amita Bide from the Tata Institute of Social Sciences, who would really look at it from the point of view of social protection and the labor market itself. What are the implications for us? So over to you, Professor Darshini.
Thank you for the invitation to this interesting study and to think about it. You know, numbers of studies have been coming out, and they are really very valuable statistics for us all to mull upon. Now, I just want to make comments here in three kind of issues. One is, I had small comment on the presentation. See more as analyzed from the data that has been collected, because that gives us more guide to the policy implications, and then I'll come to implications on urban planning. Very quickly on the presentation, I think the small issue with regards to the questionnaire, and I don't know why the question on whether all members possess ration cards was asked, because I understand ration card is a household level thing. Second is that because now that Debolina has said, clarified that the slums picked up are where World Vision is working. So we might want a little more information on the slums where World Vision is working and have been picked up for the survey. Because if I would take a different set of slums, for example, where construction workers are living or where some of the recent migrants are living, I would get entirely different sets of statistics on access to water, etc. So I think that kind of clarity is required. The setting of the study needs to be clearly stated. The second thing is that what I would have liked to see in the study, which gives us more policy direction, is that any such kind of a disaster or what we call pandemic in this case happens, there would be this immediate impact, what has been presented today. And you're going to look at medium-term impact doing this study after 6 months. What one would also like to see is that those who have been so badly impacted, is there any possibility of them coming out of poverty in the, let's say, after a year or so, or even longer time? Because some of the population that have been studied might have long-term impact, and which we are not envisaging now, and we need to probe that issue further. Second issue, and one would have liked to see more analysis, was how different cities are behaving differently with regards to entitlements, conditions within which people are living, etc. And why there are so much that differences in impacts. And I think that might have to do with the policies at the city level of extent of welfare policies different cities and states have. So if these findings are interpreted in the larger policy context, would give us more interesting insight. Last thing that I didn't hear much on the tenants versus owners, because there's huge difference with regards to how the such kind of pandemics impact owners versus the impact tenants. I will now come to the implications on urban planning, because that's what I've been asked to speak. And what this pandemic does bring out, and those who are working like us who've been working on urban planning, we know very well that urban planning has been, as a discipline, a response to pandemics in the past. And then we suddenly forgot that the planning is for public health and hygiene and for larger welfare, so to say. And as urban planning has moved on, and now in recent time, urban planning is expected to address issues on improving resilience in the cities on account of various disasters, on account of climate change and its impacts and so on. And now we see this pandemic coming up, and it takes us back 100 or 200 years back, when urban planning did come up as a response to plague and so on. In the process, as we moved in India in the last 70 years, we have forgotten that. And earlier urban planning, before 1990 reforms, so economic opening up or privatization, the welfare aspect of urban planning was sort of obliquely addressed, and it became more technocratic planning rather than dealing with well-being. And since we have this rhetoric of cities as engines of growth, planning has completely moved out of the territory of welfare into creating assets and economic growth and so on, within which we've forgotten that how do we take care of the workers who are there engaged, employed in these various economic activities in the cities, workers who are there in the construction sector. Because finally, we have to look at the implications of such pandemic on planning when we look at issues of livelihood, housing, access to land, and access to other resources, urban resources, particularly transport and other services. And I think we've moved very far away. And if you look at in the last 10 years or so, we've been talking about mega projects and things like that, but one is not sort of saying much about how, for example, any planning effort has improved health conditions and so on. So I think urban planning has to now centralize issue of welfare as a part of its main agenda of interventions in the city. That then takes me to the second point, is that which are the areas where we need more attention? And to me, I mean, I've been working on housing, and there are many articles also which are now articulating that housing, if left completely to the market, is not going to create living conditions that are conducive for us to address issues coming off pandemic and health impacts, because as I think now we have studies, and Mr. Thomas also mentioned that we have now the cases registered more in slum areas and dense areas. I mean, density per se could be an issue, but more than density, it is crowded living conditions in certain kind of housing. For example, there are certain wards, and I did this piece for Wire earlier, that in certain wards in Ahmedabad where there are more than 5 people living in a single room, these are the areas which have got more cases than other areas where crowding is less, which is an issue which is of housing, which is directly linked to how the land markets and housing markets work. And I think we have to bring back question of non-market provisioning of certain basic aspects, including housing, water supply, sanitation, and public transport. I'm glad to hear the issue of transport that came up in the children's issues that was presented. So at this, and last thing is, and that is my worry about urban planning, is that the elites have reacted very strangely in this pandemic. And I think the kind of rhetoric and talks that are around of stigmatizing people who have been infected because of this virus, it's basically probably being argued, it could come up that not in my NIMBY phenomenon, not in my backyard. I don't want urban poor living near me. There has been segmentation and segregation within our cities, and I'm afraid that through this might get enhanced. And is urban planning going to look at this very serious aspect of cities that we are living in today get aggravated on account of the pandemic, or we know that there are pandemics and there would be externalities and everybody is going to be affected, and it is better that we improve living conditions for all within our cities. Thank you.
Thank you so much. And I particularly want to respond to that comment you made on how elites have reacted not particularly very well. And it's a bit of an irony, because the pandemic was brought about by the elites who returned from their overseas visits, rather than having emanated from within urban slums or clusters where the poor live. And I think that's a very critical and valid point, particularly in the context of how we look at cities and city designs in the future. Thank you so much. But again, like I said, in the interest of time, there is so much to be said. We have been, in some sense, deluged by questions, which is a very good thing, because it shows that there is interest in the study. But without further ado, I would ask Dr. Bidhe to make her comments, to make her response, and would invite her to do so right away. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Thomas. So as I said, this is an extremely timely and a very valuable study. Looks at multiple dimensions of what are the impacts of the lockdown. And I've been asked to speak from the social protection and the welfare point of view. So I'm going to restrict my comments to that. Okay. So again, perhaps like Professor Mahadevia, I'm going to first begin with a small comment on the survey and the study itself, where I actually didn't hear much about the identity of slum dwellers as workers and what are their forms of livelihood. We heard that their livelihoods were broken or that there was a heavy decline in income, but what did they actually do is something I think which is critical. And I begin with this comment basically because for a very, very long time, I think within statistics as well as within academic studies itself, there has been this divide between looking at slum dwellers on one hand and then workers, almost as if these are entirely different segments of population that one is talking about and not really overlapping categories. One of the things which is critical with respect to social protection, I think, is really that for many, many workers, their identity as workers itself is not recognized. So perhaps if one asks, if you are a domestic worker and whether you are registered as part of the domestic worker welfare boards which have been created? Are you a construction worker, and have construction workers been included in the entire construction worker board? I think these are important questions to ask. We are aware, for example, that the central government in the second week of the pandemic somewhere declared that the cess which has been collected by the different construction worker boards through different states were asked to be released after keeping them on hold for several past years. So what has that cess actually been used to, and whether it reached some of these workers at all? And I think these are critical questions really to ask at this stage. So this identity as workers, and I think the loss of jobs is definitely there, but what we need to think about is whether the instruments which were put in place to precisely take care of this loss of livelihood, which are like insurance which was put in place, have they been able to reach the people at all? And at least the indications from what you say, it seems like it has not been there, though we don't really know for sure, because this identity as workers has not been explored. The second, I think, very interesting understanding for social protection comes from an understanding of people who stay in settlements as citizens of the city and of the country per se. And here comes in the entire question of social security, welfare measures, and also the outreach of the other financial inclusion schemes which were announced post the lockdown. I think all the questions, Professor Kundu in her presentation talked about the bank accounts and whether people had received the 500 rupees which were supposed to be the cash transfers for 3 months and which were supposed to be there. The Jan Dhan Yojana was really celebrated as one of the most successful achievements of the government. Do we see that Jan Dhan Yojana and therefore this linking of the bank accounts happen? Because to me, the pandemic has been like the acid test for that Jan Dhan Yojana. And if you look at the outreach over there, one will come up with several, blind spots which have been there, and cases of actually exclusion. The second dimension, perhaps, ration cards. Professor Mahadevia talked about whether ration cards are essential. In some ways, a ration card is a very, very interesting document. And today, in several cities, it has emerged as both entitlement as well as a fault line along which different states have tried to distinguish between people who are their own or settlers and people who are migrants. How does this divide actually come into the way of different welfare schemes? Whether it is Kerala who talks about migrants as guest workers, or whether it is the more welcoming language of a Telangana state which talks about aap hamare mehman ho, aap yahan pe kaam ke liye aaye ho. So I think these are interesting sentiments, but how these sentiments are actually translated into actual delivery mechanisms and whether they are able to reach people, I think is a very, very critical thing. And what this survey actually tells us is the shortcomings in many of these new schemes which were initiated, the different measures which were initiated by different state governments in outreaching people who were vulnerable and people who were poor. There is a last comment which I really want to make, and which is actually again something which is more in some ways theoretical, but again this thing about, are slum dwellers poor? And this is the question that one comes back with the new comment which Professor Kundu talks about, which is about the new poor. And so what we are actually talking about is that there are people who were already poor, whose conditions have worsened. There are people who were not so poor, who were moderately poor or not poor, and their conditions perhaps have also, they have been pushed into poverty. And I think with both of these, then are the moderately poor going to be ever, will not be yellow ration card holders, they are not part of the TPDS scheme. How will their entitlements progress as one moves further? And I think this is one of the very, very critical questions. The final comment that I will make is, I found the entire focus on several vulnerable segments within the family, talking about women's issues, talking about children's issues, extremely fascinating. Because often these segments are completely ignored. And what is happening with respect to the welfare of these segments? What is happening with respect to the Anganwadi program, the ICDS program? What is happening with respect to the midday meal schemes? And I think Professor Kundu gives us good, interesting examples of where midday meals were on. But I think the question to be asked is also further. What has happened to the food with respect to adolescent girls? What has happened to the food with respect to pregnant and lactating women? Are those systems existing? What has happened to the insurance programs which link to the health sector? And I think there are many more such questions which today one will see that cities, in their entire mindless thing about pursuing an economy, have just ignored the welfare system. We have lost the entire thing of in thinking about cities as growth engines. We have lost the thinking that cities also need to be caring places. They need to look at their citizens as also people who need to lead a good quality of life, which needs investment. And I think that is really the fault line that we should be thinking about as we move further. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Dr. Bide. And I think, again, thank you for that very timely reminder that we need to look at cities and slum dwellers in cities as citizens. We need to look at cities more than just as engines of economic growth, but certainly as places where citizens live with dignity, they can serve with dignity. And I know that there are several questions that you have raised. Some of them could really be the subject matter for some of our future research, because as Anjana announced during her presentation, at the end of her presentation, that this is something that is intended to be continued. So hopefully we will continue to explore some of those dimensions and get some of those answers. For World Vision, particularly because we are a child-centered organization, any research initiative without looking at children and hearing their voices, and because of the fact that in many of these cases, the caregiving and the bulk of the caregiving is by women and mothers in the home, I think looking at it with that gender lens is particularly very critical and important. So that would not be unusual, and I'm glad that that's something that has struck you. But I think all the questions that both you and Dr. Darshini have asked and raised, I think, are very relevant and important for us as we continue with our investigation of some of the issues and challenges that we face in our cities. I know that we have kind of overshot time, but I would just take just a few minutes more. I think it'll be not fair if we ask some questions of the panelists. I'll just ask one each to each of the panelists. And then we obviously would continue our discussions with both Dr. Darshini and with Dr. Bide as we move along. So the question I'd ask first to Clara is that, was there a specific question or a specific attempt in the study to look at issues faced by children with disability? And the second question is around academic activities, that the academic activities seem to have been reduced by only about 4.5%. Why would that be? It's not as if children who go to the public school system would necessarily have virtual schooling access. Is it just that they were all on holiday? So what could that be? So So can I ask Clara to answer those two questions very quickly? Okay, if Clara is having problems, I think she's having some problems with the connection. So let me go over to Anjana. Anjana, a couple of questions that came up were the fact that there seemed to be a fairly large proportion of the children who had access to internet in Anantnag. That seems a little counterintuitive. As well as the question in, the other question was about Bangalore, where the internet access seemed inordinately low for a city which is India's IT capital. It was the lowest among all the cities in terms of internet access for children. Your comments on that?
Yeah, one thing in Anantnag, the number of households that we have covered is only 50. And out of 50, 51.5% had internet access. That is one thing that we have found out. And it's very interesting to note in Bangalore that 2% of the online platform, and this being a IT hub, so we were just thinking why it is like that. So then it was found out that the communities where we actually are operational, they're mainly migrant laborers and daily wage laborers. And very few of the households only had access to Android phones. And because of the loss of income, the recharge facility was not available for these households. So children are not able to access the online platform.
Okay. That's quite likely because World Vision focuses on the most vulnerable children in whichever location that it is based in. So our particular focus on children who are most vulnerable would mean that we reach out to people who are the most excluded in any community. So that clearly is has probably come up as well. Clara, are you able to come back and answer? Or if it's okay, then I'll pass. I'll just go on to Debolina. Debolina, there were requests about whether the slides could be shared. You could probably convert them into PDF files and share them. There were some comments about some data that needed cleaning up because Edil Nagar was supposed to have been shown as under Bangalore, whereas it is really in Chennai. So some of those kind of questions which would be shared, but that again is something that would come up at some point. There is one question which is again gender linked, and the question that came up there was do you think the fact that liquor shops were closed contributed to higher gender violence during this period, or problems in the home? It's an opinion that is kind of sought from you. But again, speaking about gender, one of the very, very obviously noticeable facts about this panel is that it was an all-woman panel. And I think that is something that we should really celebrate. And in some sense, it's good that I'm the only male who is in some sense an outlier to the entire panel. So it was really nice to hear the women in our midst, talk about this and talk about the issues so eloquently positively. So I'll stop and hand over to you, Debolina, so you could take it forward and also close the session. Thank you.
Mr. Thomas, could you go back to the first two questions? I just lost you then.
Okay, the question was that would it be possible to share the slides? Maybe yeah. as a PDF version, it can be circulated. The second was there was a mention that Edil Nagar, which is a settlement in Chennai, was included under Bangalore. So that's something that we may need to just do a quick cleanup of data. So we just need to...
I have already responded in the chat.
Sure. That's fine. So the other question then to you was about this whole issue of gender violence, as to whether violence in the home was to some extent, can it be alluded to the fact that liquor shops were closed? You could argue it both ways, but what is your...
So this was one of the questions which we asked the women, and the very important observation which you made about the panel, it's all women. So in our households which I surveyed as a pilot, they were again answered by women. So women there mostly mentioned that because of the lockdown and liquor shops being closed, gender violence was limited. That was one answer. And another thing which comes to our mind when we interviewed over phone is that the husbands were present while the ladies answered. So that restricted their views to certain extent. So they were taking care of the husband's opinion while they were answering. I think
they were far more constrained in the way they were able to
answer. Exactly. They were constrained in answering the actual scenario. So she did mention that my husband threw the phone. And then she said, no, because the phone was it was old, it was old-fashioned. That's the reason my husband threw the phone. So immediately she converted the question in a positive manner, the response which she gave. And yes, the slides will be available in a few hours from now for dissemination. So that will be there. And as Anjana ji had mentioned that we will take up a survey, maybe post-lockdown once and again create, and we'll go back to the same. And I would just like to respond to one of the comments which was done by Professor Bhide. I think all the comments which came from both our discussions are very important. We did have in mind to really look at various issues, but because of dearth of time, and we thought that most of the respondents would really lose patience in answering a huge questionnaire, so we restricted. First we had a bigger questionnaire, but then we brought down to 40-45 questions. That's one thing. And on the areas, services, we did ask a question, and in one of my slides I did mention that maximum households were engaged in the service sector, followed by construction, which was around 17%, followed by trade and hotel and transport. And 46% were casual laborers who were the hard hit. And regular salaried were 28, and self-employed, those who were running carts and push carts and all, they were around 23. So that was taken care of in our survey. And again, on questions on ICDS and what happens to the lactating and pregnant mothers, those were there, but we had to cut down because of paucity of time, and we wanted to do a quick survey, and those challenges did come up and we restricted. But maybe in the second round and the third rounds, we will, while we go back to the same households, we will ask questions on these. And there were a few disabled people in the households who really had were facing, are currently facing challenges in accessing various health measures and things like that. So those were taken care of while we were surveying. And I would take this opportunity to thank World Vision for really helping us in conducting the survey. And this is, the collaboration has just started. So we will continue working with you. And I would like to thank our moderator, Mr. Cherian Thomas, for very nicely conducting the entire webinar. And my thanks to both our panelists, the moderators, Dr. Professor Darshini Mahadevia and Amita ji from TIS for their very important views on sharpening the research. When we go for the second round, we will keep in mind the comments which came up. And my co-panelists, both Anjana ji and Ms. Clara, I thank you for bringing in the focused discussion. And also, I would like to thank my team members and the staff from World Vision who always helped us in sharing whatever information we sought. And last but not the least, the participants who were with us for the entire duration of the webinar, I would like to thank them as well. And for the important questions they brought up, we will respond to those. And the slides will be put up for their use. And also we are going to bring up a report on this, and we will share that as well. Thank you so much.